My task today is to continue our series of lectures and to give you a framework of where we are in terms of clean energy in Russia, what is happening, what is the plan for the foreseeable future, what are challenges, what is working, what is not working. And I would like it to be more or less interactive, so I hope we'll have enough time for the questions after the lecture. So basically, I will touch today three main aspects: Russian energy strategy, energy efficiency and renewables, and climate change. And those three key bullet points, each of them deserve a separate lecture. I took a decision. I mean, what to talk about today? So I'm sure you will have questions or in more specific. To ask. So when we talk about Russian current situation in terms of energy consumption, again, Russia is the fifth highest emitter of CO2 after China, US, European Union and India. Emissions fell for most of the 90s and early 2000s as the economy declined after the collapse of the Soviet Union. For the last 5 years, it was a slight increase of carbon emissions. Fossil fuels contribute around 17% of total export revenues of the country. And we still have high level of energy intensity comparing with peers. So those are key factors on where we are in the context of clean energy, energy efficiency, and climate change. More specifically, if we talk about Russian energy strategy, there is a document, there is an official government document, Russian energy strategy by 2035. What is said in the document? That there is an intention to reduce energy intensity of Russian GDP. Okay. There is a plan to reduce dependence on Russian energy sector from foreign technologies and equipment. There is a plan to expand all possible areas of cooperation in energy field, diversification of energy exports geographically and in terms of product structure. And the government, Mr. Medvedev, is supportive to promote energy cooperation with all potential partners. Then if we go to ask our prime minister, our Minister of Energy, in his statements, you can read that we need to reduce dependence on hydrocarbons of the Russian economy in the interest of climate change by developing generation capacities by hydro, nuclear, and renewable energy. So this is the first time in the public discussion of Russian officials was confirmed that we plan to reduce dependence on fossil fuels in the interest of climate change. It happened last year a few times, and it's been confirmed by a special envoy of the Russian president this year, who did a statement on public that Russia will ratify Paris Climate Agreement. He didn't specify the month, but he said it will happen mostly likely this year. So in terms of reducing Russian GDP energy intensity by 2025 by factor of 1.6, then facilitate access to Russian energy consumers by expanding energy supplies to Asia-Pacific region, and he is confirming the idea of close cooperation with foreign partners in terms of partners and investors around the world. I will talk more specifically about investment issues because it's a quite sensitive topic since Russia cannot use foreign sources of international development organizations like World Bank or EBRD since 2014. So what's the role of energy sector in the Russian economy currently? The share of energy in GDP, energy in federal budget, and energy in exports have all decreased, which is a good thing. However, at the same time, this is a result of conditions in international energy markets. It's It means we are trying to find more balanced role for energy sector in Russian economy. There is still overdependence in terms of energy security is not that good. But there is a plan, there is a plan to address it. Fuel mix balance, numbers. Okay, almost 50% of electricity is produced of gas-fired power plants. European part of Russia lies primarily on natural gas and nuclear, while Siberia and the Far East use coal and hydro. 84% of electricity is produced using clean sources of energy if natural gas and nuclear are considered as clean. Last year, when we organized our Clean Energy Forum in November, we had a representative of the federal government. It was Mr. Kulapin, Director of Strategic Development of the Ministry of Energy. He said that from the position of the Ministry of Energy, our energy balance is very green. It's much greener than some comparable countries. He gave us an example, Poland, which was at the time preparing for climate, international climate conference in Katowice. And he said, well, look at Poland. Poland has much more coal in energy balance than Russia. And Poland is inviting everybody to come and to discuss climate change in a few weeks. So fuel mix is unbalanced. We still use nuclear, hydroelectric power plants, and we will use it in the future. So there is no plan for the government, and there is no option we will switch it off and turn to renewable energy sources completely. Natural gas in Russia is very, very important. I don't think you will see some numbers from there, but believe me or not, in terms of share in world production, in terms of share in world reserves, in terms of sharing global gas export by pipeline, Russia is in top three, top five, and in terms of LNG is expanding its capacities. So Russian natural gas in Russia is so important that any action in this sector has economically wide effect. We depend on gas and will be depending on natural gas a lot. Access to energy services in Russia. It's a very interesting thing here that when at the United Nations discussion about sustainable development goals, if you're talking about developing world, the critical point is access to electricity, access to basic services, having an electric socket in your apartment, in your house. There are a lot of countries where people live without access to electricity. For Russians, it's very, very difficult to believe in that. Because of our Soviet heritage, we inherited the system, we have it, and we take it as granted. But there are many, many countries with completely different situations. So in terms of SDG, Sustainable Development Goals, the universal access to electricity, Russia is in this condition is very much advanced. Access to natural gas is improving. It's not 100% coverage, and recently head of Gazprom, Alexei Miller, he confirmed that we will not achieve 100% coverage by natural gas pipe the whole country. There are many reasons for that, but still there is a relatively good situation. So it requires a lot of investment. You will see some figures here, or not, I will need it from this slide. Energy efficiency. As I said, in terms of energy intensity, the country faced the reduction of energy intensity since 1998 to 2008. Reduction was basically related to natural shifts from production facilities to services sector. Since 2009, policies and some mechanisms have been introduced by the government to encourage companies, to encourage public sector to be more energy efficient. Surprisingly, according to statistics, there is no big shift in energy intensity since 2008. So it's lower than we would expect. In 2009, by the federal program on energy efficiency improvement, it was set a goal of 40% energy, ambitious goals of 40% improvement in energy intensity. Now the Ministry of Energy says that we will probably achieve half of it by 2035. So this is the thing. And if we refer to some market players, so some stakeholders in the energy sector, they say, well, one of the key drivers is the low tariffs. Low tariffs for electricity, low tariffs for natural gas. It's not an incentive for companies, for businesses, to become more energy efficient. Energy efficiency in Russia, it's another source of energy. We should understand that the potential is still huge, and it's like another type of energy resource. If we achieve all the potential, we can significantly improve the situation in our economy. In 2007, World Bank did a survey on Russian energy consumption and Russian energy efficiency, compared it with peers to assess energy intensity and user inefficiency, lack of policy instruments, and they came up with some recommendations. It was a meeting with then president of the World Bank, Bob Zelig. He visited Mr. Putin and Mr. Medvedev. So he gave at the meeting, he gave one figure to them, saying that Russia can save 45% of its total primary energy consumption, which is equal to the annual primary energy consumption of France. So the amount France is using every year, we're just spending like opening the window. Okay? So it's going to the atmosphere, which is not very nice to the environment, which is not very nice to the economy. And there is it's a huge potential for everybody, for equipment providers, for services providers, for consultants, for companies, and for residential sector. Then it was another study asking Russian companies what they think about energy efficiency, what they think about their business, what energy efficiency play, does energy efficiency play a role in their business strategy. Apparently, we found some very interesting data. Opportunity of energy savings was heavily underestimated. So what's the point? Small and medium companies, they don't have enough skills to assess the current situation with energy consumption. They don't have enough knowledge about best practices, and they cannot do the benchmark. They cannot compare their own companies with peers and to understand that something is wrong. I'm using two times or three times more resources on cooling, compressed air, heating, water, electricity, gas, or whatever. And when you realize this potential, you can do that. Well, now it's time to do something with that. Now it's time to change behavior and time to do the modernization, to switch to new technologies and new equipment. And here comes the question where to get financial resources for this modernization. This is another big issue that if I understand that this particular boiler is too expensive for me because it's outdated, I need a new one, okay, who will invest in this new boiler? In municipal sector, the situation is even worse because the municipal sector depends on the budget, on the federal budget or municipal budget. And there is the decision-making process is much more complicated than the private sector. Here's just an example of one company completing a project. It's an industrial company. They did 36 million investment in energy efficiency in different ways. So you see that in average, the payback was 3 years. Would it be a power supply upgrade? Would it be modernization of electric motors, modernization of compressors, modernization of furnaces, cogeneration plant, and energy management system and as a whole? In average, you have 3 years payback, which shows that, yes, it's a good business. It could be a good business to invest in energy efficiency for an investor, for owner of the company. And what happened when I was doing some site visits, when I was studying the complexity and the myths and realities of energy efficiency in Russia, we were asking general managers of the company, how much are you consuming? Do you know your cost structure in terms of energy consumption? Apparently, they know only the general figure in most cases. If you're talking about small and medium companies, And the thing is that energy manager of such a small and medium company can understand in technical terms that something is wrong with the boiler, with the compression, with the transmission line, but this technical manager is not able to translate it to financial terms, to calculate the payback, to calculate potential savings, and what will be the payback out of those investments. And that's the thing. And in turn, that financial manager cannot understand technical terms. So you need somebody like an intermediate, like a negotiator, to come to sit together with financial manager and general manager and technical engineer of the company and ask proper questions. And then out of these questions come with the plan that now you can see what is the priority. The priority is the project which has a payback of less than 1 year, modernization of furnaces. Definitely, it's your biggest like problem if you are an owner of this business. You have to change this furnace. The project that is power supply upgrade, which is 3.4 years payback, you can forget about it for now. You can leave it for the next year, probably. Those are some examples of Russian companies which completed energy efficiency projects. Just to give you understanding that energy efficiency was not a purpose to do something. The purpose was to expand the business, to produce more, to improve the quality of the product. This was a chocolate fabric, chocolate factory. They did a market survey in the region that people like chocolate. They want to buy more chocolate. So the plan of the general manager was to increase the production. They selected automatic chocolate line. And when we started to realize the investment required for this chocolate line, we started to check what will be the energy cost savings. Apparently, because this equipment is completely new, completely automatic, it will save on electricity, on water, on steam, on packaging, on everything. And in total, the payback was 2 years. Improved product quality, increase in output capacity. But the purpose of the manager taking decision to invest in this new line was to expand operations of the company, not to do energy efficiency for the sake of doing energy efficiency, and if I may say so, not to save the planet from the climate change threat and blah, blah, blah. So the general manager was concerned about his business targets, okay? So this is clear. You should understand that if you're talking about general public in Russia, if you're talking about small and medium companies, well, climate change, clean energy is something which is very, very far from their day-to-day agenda. It's just coming to this country. It's a process which will take time. Hopefully, this energy observer will help us to raise a little bit awareness about clean energy sources. And we have a lot of engineers here in city that will come, ask questions. They will be maybe quite skeptical. They will say, okay, you have a diesel engine in the back of this boat probably, right? So we'll see. Another project from the south of Russia, sunflower oil producer. The company was producing sunflower oil. Every year they had to pay environmental penalties to get rid of sunflower seed husk. It's a waste from the sunflower, from the raw material. Instead of paying environmental penalties for this waste, they managed to find a boiler capable to burn it as a fuel. So they switched this waste into the fuel. So it's like waste to energy project. I like it because since this project was completed, now all sunflower oil producers, they have this equipment installed and they understand perfectly that this is like a business strategy for them. They can save a lot on gas savings here. It's about $40,000 payback, less than 3 years, which is very good in Russian economic conditions. And the last project, very specific in car manufacturing plant, they did a lighting system retrofit. The first thing comes to mind of Russians, if you talk about energy efficiency, is lighting. You have to change the light bulb. Okay, so here, this is the new lighting system, completely changed. Investment $300,000, savings $100,000 per year, which is amazing, and improved quality of lighting. For this industry, particular industry, for other industries, the quality of lighting is very important because it has direct correlation with the quality of the final product. So there are a lot of additional benefits of doing energy efficiency, multiple benefits of doing energy efficiency, that companies, they just don't know, they don't understand. We did last year the material for our students, for our friends, for companies operating in Northwest region. We collected all cases of energy efficiency in the Northwest region just to show to companies that somebody in your region, maybe in your business, in a similar business, is already doing some energy efficiency improvements, and you can copy, paste this experience. And you can go and see if it's profitable, if it's if they like it, you can do the same project. So you can also benefit from energy efficiency. So again, in terms of energy strategy, some conclusions. Russia is rich in energy resources, gas reserves, coal reserves, oil reserves. Russia is absolute leader in energy exports. Access to modern energy services is universal. If you take electricity, practically very high coverage in terms of natural gas. Renewables in the energy mix, besides large hydro, okay, have the potential to increase. Yes, the renewable energy, if we're talking about wind and solar, is still marginal. By 2030, the prognosis of International Renewable Energy Agency says that Russia can achieve from 11 to 15% of renewable energy, wind and solar. Our energy strategy says we will probably have between 2 and 4%. In our energy balance. So comparing with other sources, you can understand the difference. However, there is a common understanding that renewable energy can solve a lot of problems for the country, can help a lot to develop R&D, to develop new technologies, to create new workplaces. And it's a very good technical solution for remote regions as well, because there are still regions where access to electricity or access to other types of energy is complicated. There are some regions where you can just need equipment to run 24 hours, 7 hours a day, and wind turbine or solar panel would be logical solutions. And there are some other examples that large energy companies in Russia, they are now investing a lot. Several energy companies, big energy companies, they announced big plans of launching solar PV, wind energy farms in Russia, and this will be growing and growing. This will depend on the government support. They need some incentive from the government to make the investment structure profitable for them, but this will be, I think, we will see it booming in some regions, this new types of renewable energy. And as I said, energy efficiency is slowly improving trend, not as far as we would like to, but its overall energy intensity of the Russian economy is decreasing. So now the last component for today, climate change and Paris Climate Agreement. Who, by the way, who saw this document? Who can tell us what is the main task of the Paris Climate Agreement? What are key objectives of the Paris Agreement? Can you raise the hand? I will not ask you direct questions about numbers, but just in terms of awareness. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Excellent. So, Russian perspective. Russia is concerned by the changing of climate. Temperatures in the Arctic zone are increasing much faster than in other territories. About 10 million people, according to the Ministry of Environment, may be concerned by immediate climate-related risks. Negative effects already costing the country from 30 to 60 billion rubles yearly. And the forecast is, as Minister of Natural Resources and Ministry of Environment data, it will be increasing this figure. National Adaptation Plan is being developed as part of ratification process for the Paris Climate Agreement. I hope, I'm an optimist, I hope we will finally ratify it, together with other countries like Turkey, for example. And in terms of urban infrastructure, it's a very, very critical thing that Moscow, St. Petersburg, and few large cities, they have climate adaptation strategies or plan developed so far. Not so many cities, civil servants, you may find civil servants who understand what is the climate risks. What are climate risks for the city, what are the potential consequences, and how to deal with that. Even in St. Petersburg, with the quite substantially developed technical explication of what are climate risks for St. Petersburg as a city, there are still questions, for example, in terms of energy efficiency of our housing stock. Buildings, they emit a lot, and you have to do something with buildings. And the existing housing stock, old buildings, multi-apartment buildings in Russia built in 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s, nobody was taking care about energy efficiency at that time. For new construction, you have energy efficiency standards, but for all buildings, you need to do something with them. Key elements of the Paris Convention. While there is an agreement below 2 degrees Celsius, developed countries should contribute to developing countries. There is a need to invest 100 billion per annum as a financial support to developing countries by 2020 annually. And this is just a plan. This is not happening now, this amount of investment. A lot of companies, they ratified the agreement, including China, US and India. US, you know, Donald Trump, he declared that US will withdraw, but several states, they contradict to the president. They say, okay, you will withdraw, we will stay. California, for example. So, key elements of the Russian position. And this is the information from the very beginning of the signature of the Paris Agreement till now, the last meeting in December that happened in Poland. Russia showed much stronger climate focus. Russia confirmed 30% emission reduction by 2030. Russia insisted, together with other countries, on legally binding targets for all, saying that if we agree on certain targets, everybody should commit for those targets. Then it was a discussion about carbon tax or carbon pricing. It's still ongoing. It's a very important part. Without carbon taxation, carbon pricing, the private engine will not start working. There is no too much incentive to do anything around that. Surprisingly, business in Russia was supportive. I will tell a little bit about it later. And again, as I said, according to the special envoy of the Russian president, the ratification is being planned for 2019. So Russia was deeply involved, in fact, in development of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change and the Kyoto Protocol. And the climate doctrine was approved in 2009. So we are fully aligned with other countries in this dialogue. And we fulfilled our obligations during the first Kyoto Protocol, although not so many companies, they benefited from this Kyoto Protocol, but still there is an official position. And I attended a meeting in Moscow 2 weeks ago, organized by Russian Academy of Sciences, RAN. It was a debate about energy and climate, and it was a very, very like explicitly straightforward position that we understand that changing climate is changing because of the human activity. Despite some critics in the room at that meeting, top scientists in the climatology, in meteorology, they confirmed that yes, we all agree that this is because of human activity. There is no doubt. There are some skeptics. In every country you may find skeptics. In Russia, you will also see some skeptics saying that this is everything like inspired by somebody to do bad for the country. Well, the official scientists in Russia, they say we participate in UN climate negotiations since last century, and we agree that this is because of the human activity. There is no scientific debate. There are some skeptics, but still, I mean, they will still be with us for many years. Who is driving the climate agenda in the country? So there is, as always, you start from the top in this country, President Putin, special presidential advisor on climate change, which is, it's very important that we have the special advisor on climate. I think in the hierarchy of our government, I mean, you need somebody to be a champion in this particular topic. Otherwise, it follows down to the agenda of different ministries. At the end, if you have multiple people like responsible for something, I mean, you cannot figure out who I can talk to, who is responsible for that. Then Ministry of Energy, Ministry of Economic Development, Ministry of Environment and Natural Resources, Federal Forestry Agency, and Federal Meteorological Agency. I forgot one ministry, it's the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. They oversee all international negotiations from the Russian side, and also they have some experts on climate, surprisingly, quite well prepared. I had a chance to see their contribution during the official presentations of Russian position. So Putin in 2015, when it was the Paris meeting to sign the agreement to announce the global agreement on climate, he confirmed that, yes, climate change is a serious global threat. Yes, the global warming is damaging economy and environment. Russian contribution to climate change is significant. We do a lot. It's possible to save environment and develop the economy. So it's like a win-win. We support 2 degrees Celsius target for all countries. We support for developing countries. We understand that support for developing countries is important. And Russia is a donor now since 2011. Russia is a donor, an international donor scheme. Russia is financing some developing projects abroad in developing countries. And again, he confirmed that we would like to see legally binding agreement for all member countries. It's required. Ministry of Energy. What is the position of Ministry of Energy? Well, as a Ministry of Energy, they say fossil fuel contribute around 70% of Russia's total export revenues. Full stop. I mean, this is the message. It's very important for the economy. Yes, we understand that Russia is the fifth largest greenhouse gas emitter. Yes, we know that it was a decrease in emissions due to the collapse of the Soviet Union, and we started to switch from industries to service, more service economy. And we know that emissions have been on a slow rise, but the current level is still below the level that we should be looking at as a baseline. Ministry of Economic Development is in charge of everything in Russia, as I heard 2 weeks ago from the one of the ministerial conferences, if we are talking about economic development. So they are developing the legislation supporting renewables and energy efficiency. And they did a lot in terms of creating some incentives, some initiatives. What they say, international sanctions are blocking Russia access to global financing for emission reduction measures. What does it mean? World Bank, and IFC, European Bank for Reconstruction and Development are not operating in Russia since 2014. And these long-term financial resources are not available for the country. It's a pity because it was a significantly important part of international investments going to renewable energy and energy efficiency projects, including the municipal sector. Lobbying by the fossil fuel industry is another obstacle, is another issue that there are some companies, they are lobbying directly or indirectly, saying that we don't need carbon taxes, we don't need any carbon incentives, we don't need to talk about any other specific incentives or plans in terms of carbon reduction and making economy carbon neutral. And some businesses, which is true, is fearing that a new carbon regulation might decrease the overall bureaucratic burden on companies. So they say, okay, you will just introduce the new regulation, you will ask us to pay more taxes. Look at Sweden. In Sweden, there is a carbon tax, 100 euro per ton. It's too expensive, we cannot afford this. You will just increase the pressure on the business and the business will close. A lot of people lose their jobs. So it's very important to hear this voice. Ministry of Natural Resources and Environment. Yes, they confirmed that climate change may result in economical losses. that Russia is becoming more and more active in the Arctic Council in terms of what it concerns the environment, environmental issues. And Russia offers even some funding to the Global Environmental Fund for environmental projects and climate change projects abroad on the condition of unlocking the potential fundings for projects in Russia. So it's very important for us to see, money goes both ways. So we invest abroad for developing countries. We expect some international funding become available in the country, for the country. Federal Forestry Agency responsible for all our monitoring, what is happening, prevention of fires and black carbon emissions. And there is a plan to strengthen monitoring, increase capacity of special forestry, fire brigades, engage business, academia and NGO in the dialogue of protection of forests. Because we have forests, it's like our way to address the climate change issue because of the carbon emission. It's important. And the last one, Federal Meteorological Agency, reports to the Ministry of Natural Resources and Environment, responsible for participation at UNFCCC and Kyoto Protocol, and they do regular monitoring and reporting about meteorology and environmental issues. They issue a very interesting report on a regular basis on the scientific part, like on assessing the situation with changing climate in Russia. Which are the regions most affected, what are potential consequences for specific industries, for people, for nature, and it's a very important document. I will encourage you to read it if you want to get more details. I think the executive summary is translated, is available in English. So there is a conservative reduction plan based on the level of 1990 in terms of energy, in terms of carbon emission. There are new rules for emission control, which will first be implied to large companies, large emitters. There are some ideas in terms of forestry and new technologies, but no clear strategic plan yet. And the push for carbon regulation is coming from both businesses and the government. One particular interesting point here that experts say Russia tried to use common climate and environment agenda to restore relations with the West. So environment is something is common for us. We have to sit together on the round table and discuss and try to find a solution. It's our common interest. Role of business. Five Russian companies before COP21 in Paris in 2015 agreed to issue a common statement and invite more Russian companies to set up a Russian partnership for climate and to join efforts in discussing what the business can ask from the government and what the business can do in terms of addressing climate change. Russian companies have introduced an initiative to consolidate the efforts of Russian businesses to mitigate environmental impacts. And this is the initiative that signals another step forward to introduce new climate agreements at the upcoming UN conference. Now we have about 20 partners in this climate partnership. European University is one of the partners. We joined this institution in 2017. And so far, we're doing a lot of awareness. We're doing a lot of information exchange. And on our regular meetings, we plan our activities and we try to engage business, more business, and more engage the government in the discussion how to address climate in the country. And you may see here some big banks, insurance companies, industrial companies, mining, aluminium producer, and business associations, and there are more to come, which is a very good signal, I think, because those companies, they have certain responsibility for the society. They have to start this process. So I will not. You can see my presentation. We'll put it on the website for the sake of time. Some conclusions. Even Russia is not making a lot of public statements about Paris Agreement or UN development goals. The development of the country is in line with UN Sustainable Development Goals, and we are committed for this. Access to modern energy services is universal, as I said. Renewables, besides hydro, have the potential to increase. Okay. And there are targeted actions by some companies. There are plans by some companies to introduce more renewable energy. Energy efficiency is slowly improving trend. And clean energy, investment in clean energy, there are significant problems with investment climate overall that prevents, in particular, including investments in the clean energy sector. And overall characteristic is the central role of the natural gas for the economy. This is the reality. Thank you very much. If you have questions.
Yes. First of all, I don't come from a background in engineering. I come from architect and designer. I graduated as an architect in my home country, in Ecuador. And then I came to Europe to study landscape architecture. So I have this background as well. So I want to argue for the forest. First of all, I don't think like science always is an absolute. Like there is always some discoveries. And like for example, I know a scientist from St. Petersburg. Her name is Anastasia Makayeva. She is, I don't know her personally. I know her research. I have read her research through it. You don't need actually to talk to her, but through her research is amazing. And I think it should be included in these lectures in the future, because I think I, as South American, I am more aligned to what she says than what you explain here in this presentation. So I think first the institution that you give classes to, I think it should be more realistic and have more points of view to come out with a more better education for the students. And I think science is a really important subject. Anastasia argues about CO2 emissions, which is has numbers of that the CO2 is not the cause of global warming. Therefore, it, as a university, maybe as Russia, don't need to align with this CO2 European way of seeing how global warming is just through CO2. I think also gas has a byproduct gas, of course, that could go to the atmosphere. But has anybody analyzed the byproduct if this causes global warming? And also, there is another question. She argues, Anastasia Makayeva argues that the CO2 is not the cause of global warming. The cause of global warming is deforestation, and that the carbon cycle is not so important as the water cycle. And she has a concept about the biotic pump, the forest as a biotic pump, meaning that the deforestation is the main cause of, and the human change in the landscape is the main cause of global warming. So I would like to see her point here standing, because that's actually why I came, not why I came to Russia, but just to get in touch with this kind of people who think different than all the rest of the world.
Okay, so I would consider that you just made a suggestion that we invite people with other point of view.
She's from the nuclear physics.
Fantastic, it's brilliant. And we will ask some physicists and mathematics to join from another side. Because my plan for the next year, for maybe September, October, or November period, to have debates on energy and climate in St. Petersburg. Because we have a lot of talented experts in different fields, and we will try to contact them and to understand what's their view and set certain like scenario for debates around climate. So I take it very, very like straightforward advice from you. Thank you very much. Are you from Chile? No?
No, I'm from Ecuador.
Okay. Thank you. Please.
After your presentation, you mentioned a lot about renewable generation, and you could also give examples about basically consumption, efficiency consumption. My point is, I didn't hear much in your presentation about self-generation and then connected to the grid, to the national grid. Because you can be an auto-producer, for example. A company can generate their own energy during the day and during the night, for some reasons or for another period, could deliver to the grid for other use. Is this, I have not seen or I have not heard in your presentation. Is the legislation ready for that? This is basically my question, because that will involve a lot the changes.
Well, the system of net metering in the pure, like, in the ideal situation, like it's now, it does exist in different European countries, we are far from that. Companies, they can have access to the grid. It is regulated by specific energy legislation. It's complicated because we still have a certain monopoly around the grid. And nobody is interested in buying your electricity, to be honest, fully honest with you. So if you want to install a wind farm in your factory, I mean, and consume 100% of this electricity, it's okay. I mean, you can do. You can just meet some safety requirements and that's it. But if you'd like to sell it, well, this is, I think, the future. Again, when I speak to the grid operator, the concern is about stability of the grid. Because some energy sources may deliver me the electricity to the grid when I don't need it. So that's a question. We recently had a meeting with one interesting businesswoman in St. Petersburg. She's developing the system of electric chargers for electric vehicles. And what she says that basically there is an interesting potential scenario to consider. At night, the city is not consuming a lot. But at night, you can put your car and charge it when there is extra surplus of electricity. And then during the day, this electric car will drive you around the city. So this is the way to address like energy balance and do a proper mix. But again, this requires in the big cities like St. Petersburg, it requires a lot of planning. So technically, it's possible. Legally, it's complicated. Yes.
I'm the Mispah from Institute of Energy and Transport System, Politech University. First, I would like to thank you for a very interesting presentation about the energy efficiency for the future here in Russia, because I was really disappointed before when I came here in Russia, because I was looking for resources and during the internet, there's like a stereotypical thing about Russia. You don't care about the renewable energy. And when I saw this in the presentation, I was really amazed, because there are many important points that you have mentioned. But there is one little point, but you know, the consequences of this point is like the main cause of the global warming is not like, as you mentioned, the CO2. There is the methane gas, which comes from the waste. And one of the main aspects that for the energy, to reduce the energy consumption is to reduce the weight, the waste. So I haven't seen like any future plan for the reduction of the waste or recycling the waste here in Russia. So is it will be included in the future? Because the waste is like 86% more dangerous and consider 86% the main cause for the global warming, like more than CO2. So is it like to be included in the future? Because there are many, for instance, in the United States, they start recycling waste, like the municipal solid waste, the normal waste, in like in a full scale. Like they are not separating like the plastic or the organic, they are just shredding the whole trash together in order to reduce the gas. This is one of the solutions. So is there in Russia, like you have mentioned in the sunflower oil, like they are recycling, reducing energy, like waste to energy. This is a very good point. But is it possible to include the waste, the normal waste, in gasification process, for instance, or for pyrolysis process?
Again, the answer is technically yes. We have a lot of advanced technologies in the country. In most cases, waste-to-energy projects work well in the private sector. If we are talking about municipality, like Moscow and St. Petersburg, some other big cities, waste collection, management, and treatment, and recycling, it's a very, very big issue. We're just starting this process. There are a lot of talks about just burning waste to produce energy. There are a lot of environmental concerns about that. I saw in Western Europe and Denmark, for example, I saw a municipal waste-to-energy plant in the city center, which is completely like environmentally clean, but it's very expensive, and I set this agenda without mentioning waste. So thank you. Maybe we should arrange another meeting to discuss it.
They start already doing this, but they are recycling the oil waste. The name of the organization, it's not the company, it's the organization, I guess. Babusha Rocket Technology. I've heard about it in Moscow. It's a really new technology for recycling the waste of oil, not like the normal waste, but there is a possibility to combine each together, I guess. So they already started in Moscow, I guess, in the but it will be launched at the end of 2019 because it's a two-part project.
Okay.
Can
Thank
I rephrase the question for him? Because I think that St. Petersburg has landfills, so they can use maybe this waste, the gas that it produces, and reuse this gas into the grid in the city. That's my question as a landscape architect. Sorry.
My answer is maybe, again, technically it's maybe possible. Other questions, please? Who was the... Okay, gentleman there. Yes.
Just given that Russia's economy is so reliant on fossil fuels, is there a conflict of interest between renewable energy and fossil fuels within Russia? Because if your economy depends so much on exports, then you mentioned there was 60 billion rubles worth of costs which are related to climate change, but surely that's only a fraction, a tiny part of what you actually earn every year for exporting. So how do you think Russia's going to go forward and balance those two?
Well, I think we still, in terms of the energy mix, we'll still be burning gas to produce electricity, we'll still be using nuclear power. Renewable energy, as I said, we will be developing Russia, wind and solar, because there are new technologies behind that. And this will help us to develop industries around this, to create jobs and to consider even this for export, because local solar PV producers, Russian companies who are solar PV producers, they think now about export also. So they are ambitious enough to compete with other countries who are well known for producing solar PV. The same with wind energy. If you know, for example, Anatoly Chubais, who is the CEO of the Rosnano, Russian nanotechnology company, he is now developing renewable energy. He is doing presentations at all major energy events. He is advocating for renewable energy, saying that we don't have a target to have 50% in our energy balance of renewables. But it's important for us to develop renewable energy as something new, as a way to diversify the economy then. So if we achieve 5% by 2030, if we achieve 10%, it's nice. It's very good and it's very important in terms of diversification. This is, again, the part of the exercise.
Does that mean that they're potentially stuck in a cycle whereby, because they want their economy to keep growing, they want to still be a global power, they need to keep on exporting, but at the same time, they want to try and lighten the spike, so they're stuck in a cycle where they can't get out of it. You see what I mean?
Yes.
So what's the best way to try and tackle that?
Well, there are different ways of addressing this. North Africa, Algeria, is exporting a lot and developing solar and wind energy, solar mostly, for the similar purposes. They say we export more, we earn and we invest in the country to make it clean. In Yemen, it was the estimation that instead of subsidizing electricity for households, because it's a poor country, we would better invest this money in renewable energy and provide access to cheaper electricity, because it will be cheaper when the market evolves. Okay, so please, yes.
So I'm interested in how the Russian government actually incentivizes clean energy usage in the industry.
There are, just for some practical examples, there are tax incentives for companies doing energy efficiency. For certain types of machinery that you are installing, you can get some tax reduction. It's quite complicated. I don't know statistics how companies are using this, but it legally it does exist according to our tax officials. And there are some incentives for renewable energy. There are special agreements on pricing, special pricing mechanism on tariffs for renewable energy, solar and wind, that are still in place. There is now a debate how to transform them after the period they were agreed. They are now acting by 2024. So what will be behind 2024 is now being discussed. So it's not like, I think the government has a difficult position to balance between the interest of like renewable energy, companies planning for some energy efficiency projects, and the whole economy. So you cannot incentivize one particular industry to demolish to put another industry at risk. And also there is a tendency to consider, I used to work for the World Bank project in Russia, and there is a tendency when you are saying something like, there is a special program, like technical assistance, somebody will come and help you, it will be free for you, taking this for granted, like take this report, saying, okay, there is a big potential in my country, in my company, and then it put it on the shelf and forget about it. So like you don't value what you get for granted. So for the private business, I'm sure that companies who underestimate the energy efficiency potential, for example, they will just lose the competition to others. Like it's a normal process. If you are not a good manager of your company, would it be like you don't hire the proper people, or you spend too much on your energy bill, monthly energy bill? You'll be like, tomorrow somebody will replace you. For the budget sector, for the municipal sector, this is the sector where we need a lot of measures to be taken. There are good examples in the region. If you go to Priazersk, it's Leningrad Oblast, it's from St. Petersburg to the north, to the border with Finland. The private company did an energy service agreement with the local municipality to change lighting system completely. So they installed LED lighting, street lighting. It was a very, very good project in terms of both technical solution and economic solution. And it works very well. And now they are trying to tell this story to others, saying that, well, there is a one municipality of maybe like, how many people? I don't know, 5,000 people living there. But you can copy this project. It was successful. This is the role for the government institutions to promote those successful cases. And they are doing this. In every region, we have these regional energy efficiency centers created by local governments. They have a mandate to help those individual companies implement some projects and then raise awareness, tell to others that, guys, there is a successful case. You should come and see and maybe try to replicate it in your particular case. Yes?
First of all, thank you very much for the lecture. It was pretty interesting. And I don't think there are a lot of lectures in St. Petersburg, actually, about that topic. My question is, what do you think about ecological situation and capitalism? Yeah, probably you know Bruno Latour, who wrote a beautiful, I don't know, book probably, yeah, about how capitalism and economical problems are going together, and the point of Bruno Latour is that we can't prevent ecological catastrophe before we won't deal with capitalism. And as for me, I'm not a specialist, a great specialist, but I think that Scandinavian countries are a little bit more successful in dealing with ecological problems. And do you think how capitalism affects dealing with economical problems and how socialism can deal with it? What do you think?
Thank you. It's a very complicated question, especially because you started from mentioning Bruno Latour. I have a lot of colleagues at the university. They love Bruno Latour, and they start a lot, quite often, the conversation from citating him. So I think I should finally go and read his books. And environment. It's a hot topic. It's a very important topic that you raised. Why Scandinavian countries are more advanced in terms of protecting the environment, I don't have an answer. But they managed to arrange the system when everybody is concerned about it somehow. We maybe in what you see here in St. Petersburg, not that advanced in terms of protecting the environment. If you are looking for some specific figures, there is a committee responsible for environmental protection in St. Petersburg, and they issue regular reporting on the quality of air, for example. And what they say is that, well, they do their best in terms of the atmospheric pollution. Then second thing, we used to have coal boilers in the city to have district heating operational in winter season. Now the city transformed completely this system, and now 96% of those boilers operate on natural gas, which is, by default, you cannot imagine how dirty was this coal, I think, right? So now it's much better, and again, the official position of the city government was that, yes, we did it, we did the gasification. In this particular area, we cannot do that much. In terms of transport, for example, yes, that's the issue, that pollution from transport is a big concern for the big city like St. Petersburg. And here the answer is to develop public transportation, develop electric transportation.
But the difference between alternative electricity, coal and gasoline, yes, that we still have gas and coal, so we need to choose which way we are going to develop our city. But to develop alternative energy, we need to pay money. And the topic simply, capitalists use resources, so they have gas, it's working, why they should pay for alternative energy? Why they should develop it? Because as we see, they need.
Vanil, you want to comment something?
No, I say that we should, maybe end the questions.
So we can take one question. I will respond and they will take one final question. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. So I would imagine the situation when in my apartment I have three sockets, black, green, and blue.
Yeah.
One is from natural gas, one is from coal, and one is from renewable energy. Unfortunately, it's not possible. I spoke with a large industrial company last year here in St. Petersburg. They have the mother company, the shareholder sitting in Scandinavia. And they have a request from Scandinavian shareholders. By 2023, all your electricity that you're using for your production purposes should be green. They are based in St. Petersburg. And the question, where they can get this green electricity? There is no way. I mean, they have come back and explained to investors. This is the situation. This is the reality. In the foreseeable future, it's not possible. You should consider of like changing the approach. And it's not, Russia is not unique in this situation. There are many countries that are in the same situation. Our advantage is that we have natural resources. And our advantage is that we have district heating. Otherwise, people would just die during the winter season. Okay, so last question, please.
About carbon emissions, you said a few words, but not that much about the issue of carbon taxes versus carbon permits, and how both the government and the private sector relate to it. As I understood it, but I might have not understood well. Generally speaking, both the government and even the private sector, you said more surprisingly perhaps, are fairly open, or I don't know whether we can say supportive, but what is the dynamics, the real dynamics? Because I think that in any system of that type, you have winners and losers, and so what can we expect in that rather important?
Yeah, well, it's a very important question. It's an urgent question, I would say. So now there are, I think, like in Moscow, most events related to energy and climate, they start from discussion about pricing or taxation for carbon. First of all, before you come to this to the solution of this issue, you should do something with monitoring. Because companies, they don't report on carbon. There is now an obligation for large emitters to start reporting on carbon. At the moment when we will have the system of collection, the proper data on the carbon emissions, we'll be equipped with a more reliable base for the informed decision. And well, there is, for example, it was a famous letter by Oleg Deripaska in 2015, before the Paris Climate Agreement. He wrote a letter in the foreign press asking for $15 a ton carbon tax for Russia, for Russian businesses. Again, I should remind you that in Sweden it's 100 euro per ton. And nobody is protesting, nobody is going on the street to protest. And so there is a debate. I personally don't have any yet decision would I support pricing, carbon pricing or carbon taxes. I believe more in free market, but I understand that in this particular environmental issue, it's not like purely a commercial decision or market driven decision that will help us. Thank you very much.